Welcome back to CEO Money with your guest host, Gary Leland, Tony Sakala, the Crypto Cousins. We are now joined by Scott Deatherage of S. Deatherage Law. Scott, thanks for joining us today.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Yeah, so give us a short scoop here on what's going on. Tell us about yourself, how you got into this.
So I started working with some guys in cryptocurrency mining about a year ago. They were asking me, well, where do we get cheap electricity? I mean, electricity is one of our biggest costs. And so we started talking about, you know, can you get it from wind, hydro, natural gas, coal? And as we started talking more and more, I just got intrigued by the entire area, started studying about blockchain, cryptocurrencies, started doing a little investing, doing a little mining. And then just started working with clients, blockchain consulting firms, cryptocurrency mining firms.
So what kind of electricity did they end up going with?
Well, they're still in the city, so they're just buying it off the grid. But I actually have one client that's looking at combining cryptocurrency mining with solar farms. So actually working on an ICO, so we'll see where that goes. Maybe as early as July that ICO will hit the market.
And for those who are not familiar, ICO is an internet coin offering.
Initial coin offering.
Thank you for correcting me there. So that's your shtick. That's what you're into. Now you're doing legal advice for blockchain related companies.
Exactly. And as particular expertise in electricity and environmental matters. So in the electricity world, there's something called renewable energy certificates, and I'm working with a company that's going to put all those things on a blockchain, and you know, there's more and more applications in this space.
Well, it seems like the renewable energy field is ripe for coming together with blockchain, because there's this complaint that Bitcoin miners and all the mining is using up, or quote unquote, wasting electricity. Can you address that concept?
Yeah, absolutely. So the first question is, are they wasting it or are they just using it? But since a lot of electricity is generated from fossil fuel sources, there's this concern, as there was with Apple and Microsoft when their data centers, is, well, you're using a lot of power from non-renewable sources. And what we saw was, you know, you read about Apple and Microsoft buying power from wind farms and solar farms. And I think as these cryptocurrency mining firms get bigger and bigger, they're going to start moving to renewable energy sources, hydro from dams, wind, solar, and various other renewable sources, because that is a sort of a criticism, if you will, of Bitcoin miners and other miners.
Well, today, I think we have a big flux around that right now in Washington State with Bitmain moving up there. A lot of them are moving on the Columbia River to take advantage of that power consumption that's cheap electricity, number one, but renewable, as you're talking about.
Yeah, and unfortunately, a lot of renewable sources are cheaper. You know, the cheapest electricity in the state of Texas is wind. A lot of people don't realize that. So I'm getting them to take a look at maybe some wind farms, moving some miners out into far west Texas with their oil wells, cows, and wind turbines.
Was that really that cheap, or is that cheap because of government subsidies on wind?
Well, for the customer buying it, it's cheap, but right, there is a subsidy for wind and solar currently. But the prices for turbines and solar panels are going down. They're predicting solar panels may go down as much as 36% this year.
No.
Wow. Just in 1 year.
In
wow.
1 year.
That's a big drop.
Typically, it's been 10 or 15% for the last 5 or 6 years.
Fantastic.
That is a big drop.
It is.
So now you are also real knowledgeable on smart contracts, which would make sense since you're a legal company.
Right.
And, you know, I feel like I know crypto pretty well, but I always get confused on smart contracts. That's something I do not know as well as I should. And I think there are a lot of people out there who would feel the same way. Can you give us a brief, let's get into smart contracts. Tell us what it is.
So simply think of a smart contract as like an app, a decentralized app that sits on top of a blockchain. Right now, most of those contracts sit on Ethereum, that blockchain. It's basically a program written by a computer programmer. And say, for example, let's talk about an initial coin offering. Let's say you've got a token you're selling. Someone will write a smart contract. You send me one coin in Ether or a certain amount of dollars, and it's automatically sent to your wallet, so you get the new coins. There's no human doing that. It's all computerized. So that's an example of a smart contract. Bitcoin is sort of a smart contract. most of the coins we have today are basically smart contracts that have been written by a programmer. In other applications, it could be, think of, you know, my daughter's car just got wrecked, so I had to go to the insurance company. What if there was a smart contract that says when the estimate comes in for your car, a check is automatically sent to the body shop? You know, does that cut down on the number of people you need? Does that make our insurance cheaper?
Sure. When something has to sit on someone's desk to get approved or stamped, I mean, a lot of the things that are being done, basically, it's almost like you're replacing AI. We're going to call it AI, but the smartness of it is with people who are in the loop who are really not necessary.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's the magic of the smart contract.
I get it.
So if I needed a smart contract, would I come to someone like you, Scott, and say, hey, I need a smart contract for making sure this happens? Can you help me out here? And you would set that up for me?
I would go to some of my friends, people I work with, to say, you know, let's sit down with the client. Let's talk about what they need. Let's talk about what needs to be programmed. And they would actually write the program. But if it involves any legal issues, I would be advising the client on that and helping the coder do the right work.
So, yeah, I find this whole smart contract things. Now, is it EOS, the new thing coming out for smart contracts?
Yeah, absolutely.
So now I hear a lot of people saying that's going to take the place of Ethereum. What do you think, or do you know much about that?
I don't know if it's going to take the place. You know, some people say EOS may be a great software, but it's kind of like Microsoft in the old days outdid Apple. Was Apple better? Yeah, probably. But Microsoft got bigger, faster, and became the de facto standard. I mean, there are thousands of people working on Ethereum smart contracts and apps. So maybe that's going to be the standard.
But kind of like a Sony and a Betamax.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
perfect
we
example.
We saw what happened to the Betamax, didn't we? So, Scott, we got 1 minute left. I want to make sure you tell everybody where they can find you, your website, all the information they need to get in touch with you.
Sure. You can email me at scott@scottdeatherage.law.com, or I just set up a new website called blockchaincouncil.io. If that may be a little easier to remember than my last name, and you can find me there as well.
That sounds
fantastic.
Exciting.
It's been great meeting you, and we look forward to hearing more.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming on the show. We really do appreciate it. You've been listening to CEO Money with guest hosts Gary Leland, Tony Sakala, otherwise known as
the Crypto Cousins.
Join us tomorrow. Well, we probably won't be here tomorrow, but Michael Yerba will. So join Michael tomorrow for more in-depth interviews and innovators. And remember, you can find this podcast on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Stitcher, and anywhere quality podcasts are found.